And a big hello to you. It's Tuesday the 21st of March 2017. Welcome along to tonight's United Kingdom Talk, boys and girls. We're also on Periscope this evening, which is a little camera to the left of me there. Although I have to say, if you're watching on Periscope, I won't see your messages, OK? If you're watching on Periscope for the first time this evening, welcome. We don't usually go on Periscope. I'm on Facebook Live. So if you want to follow us there, that's where you can comment. Look us up on Facebook Live, OK? So it's facebook.com/ChrisReardonUK. It's the same as my Periscope Twitter, OK? Facebook.live. Facebook.com/ChrisReardonUK. But if you want to watch on Periscope, that's all right as well. Just join us on there if you want to join in the conversation that we're having this evening. All right, boys and girls. So how are you today, my darlings? Let's say hello to some of the early people that are with us already today. Good morning to... I'm usually here in the morning, so I forget sometimes. Hello to Jerry, who's with us. Elaine's with us in Israel. Good evening, Elaine. Timothy Thomas. Hello, Timbo. Timmy Thomas, baby. Who says, good evening, sir. I've all of a sudden stung into action. What do you mean stung into action? I'm not quite sure what you mean by that. Stung into action. Do you mean slung or in your case sling? Probably sling interaction with Tim Thomas there. Hello, who's having a bit of a sugar rush. Hello, Adam the plumber's with us today. Sprung. I think it's more likely sling. I think it's more likely slim. I do. Gustav is there. Daniel's with us in Camberley. Hello, Daniel. Graham, our very good friend Graham. Good evening, Graham. Ah, Callum. Hello, Callum. Nice to see you, sir. James Clark is with us. Elaine wants to know what Periscope is. Okay, Periscope was like Periscope was before Facebook Live, and it's quite good, actually. It was quite good in those days. Now, and the reason I'm on Periscope tonight, and I'll tell you why I'm on there tonight, because I recently re-downloaded the Periscope a couple of days ago while I was having a chat with our Wendy, you know, Wendy, regular correspondent to the show. And I was just really disappointed with what was going on there. It just seems to be people who have no story to tell whatsoever, but just want to sit there and wait for the compliments to come in. You know, like, oh, you're hot. Now, obviously, I wouldn't... And they're generally young people on there. Either young girls with about 10 inches of makeup on or lads who are just looking for a hookup. Like, that's what it just seems to be to me there. So I thought I'd go on there tonight as well. Although, you know, only as like a little secondary thing. I thought we'd be on there tonight as well. Although I've got to say that I'm not kind of... That's Periscope over there and you're over there, you see. So I don't think there's anyone... It's only one person watching on Periscope anyway. So I thought I'd go on there and give them a bit of an alternative. You know, someone that might actually want to talk to them rather than just sit there and like, yeah, all right, man. How's it going? And that's all it is. That is all it is. I know you're over there, darling. Maybe if I put... Let me try moving that a bit across so it'll give you more of a more of a thing. What can I use? I need a box. Oh, that'll do. My iPhone SE box. One moment. Oh, God. There we are. I think the two will work together tonight. Will that fit in there? Oh, look. Oh, it's a bit of a squeeze. No, it won't fit in there. Hang on. Let me move that round there, and then it'll look a bit more like I'm talking to you, won't it? As well as our lovely regular Facebook people. There we go. Let's put that there. I mean, it might not be bang on, but let's just move that across. How's that? Is that going to fall over? Is it like this at the BBC? There you go. That's a little bit better, isn't it? Yeah. All right. So if you want to join us on Facebook Live, that's where you want to have the conversation with everyone. There's a lot of people on there, boys and girls. But Periscope tonight as well, just to give you something a bit alternative. Like, yeah. If any of you hot girls want to give me a chat up tonight. And then we've got to do the sucking of the teeth. Sucking of the teeth. They haven't got anything to say. They if you've been on Periscope lately, you will know what I mean. I mean, marginally, the people on during the daytime are a little bit better. There's a bloke on there called Orion, who's I don't know if he's English or he's a tourist. He possibly from China or one of the Asian countries, I don't know. Or he might be English. I haven't listened to him properly. But he goes around London with his little camera, all live, you know, walking over Tower Bridge, like, wow, look at this. And he shows you the art. I mean, that at least he's attempting to give us a bit of entertainment. Not like, yeah, yeah, man. And some of us smoking spliffs on the Periscope, actually smoking drugs. I can't believe it. What are they like? I mean, maybe we can do this show on both. I mean, well, that's exactly what I'm doing tonight. So maybe we'll do that in future to give ourselves a few more people to join it. So don't forget to thank you very much to those of you that do share the show on your various walls. That is much appreciated. OK, I don't know if anyone else has been watching Periscope lately. Has anyone else? Then do let us know. Put a little message there or you'll be able to call in later when I open the phone line. OK, Adam says, thank you, Adam. The boy, thank you. That's who I'm thinking about. The boy is called Orion. He lives here. He's actually from the Philippines. So I knew it was somewhere like that. And I actually know quite a few people from the Philippines, Adam. There's one lady. I think she's gone to live in Spain for a while now. Her name was Fedora. And she used to come along to the karaoke's. And she always sung that song by Dusty Springfield, All I Want Is You. Do you know that one? La 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 la, you know, and that sort of thing. So that's Fedora. Elaine says, I'll wait till you get here. Wait till I get there for what? Well, over in Israel. You know I'm going to come again at some point. Don't know when, though. Hello to Alan Carathas. Don't forget the pouting, Chris. Oh, yeah, the pouting on Periscope. You know. Yeah. And these girls are on there. And they're like this. Yeah. And they're just taking it all in. There's nothing. Not nothing to say. What is the point? I don't get it. I'm sure when the people who invented the excellent service called Periscope didn't expect perhaps that sort of thing. There is some good stuff on there, though. There really is. There was one young lad in Holland, and he was very good. He tried doing different things on there, you know, playing music and getting people to vote in. Do you know, I wish I'd brought a glass of water in today. Oh, I've gone all dry. I might have to pop out to the to the bathroom. If I have to pop out to the bathroom, I'll get Adam to call in and then he can fill in while I fill up a glass or two. OK, hello to Anne. Happy Kevin. Hang on a minute. Hang on. Let's just scroll down. I've gone a little bit too far up there. Good afternoon to Terry H. Oh, yeah, there's a lot of you there today. Anne's with us. Terry H is there. Hello, Terry. All right. Up in Leeds. Vince Goldsmith. Are you in Spain, darling? Hello, Vince. Good. I can't see the Periscope. Up Periscope. It's an app, Graham. Periscope is an app, okay? James says, have you got Snapchat? No, I've got enough things. Facebook, Twitter's, and it's just so much, dear. There really is so much to choose from. I've kind of limited myself to Facebook. I mean, I have got the Twitter. It's twitter.com/ChrisWhittonUK. But I rarely use it, to be honest. I've never really got Twitter. I don't get Twitter at all. Hello to Rachis. Oh, Chris, you're hot. I know. It is hot in here. I might have to turn on my air conditioning in a minute, darling. All right. How many thousands have tuned in tonight, Chris? I don't... Oh, is it 18 million tonight? I think we've got 18 million tonight. So that's not too bad, is it? So thank you very much. All right. Now let's talk about some stuff today then. I have been to the cinema tonight. No, incorrect. I've been to the cinema this morning. Well, I say this morning. I got up around about 9 o'clock this morning, rushed through my breakfast, quickly checked on the Odeon website, and I found Beauty and the Beast. Okay, 18 million and one with the one person watching on Periscope. OK, just once it was, I thought it might be a waste of time on there. So I had my breakfast. I went up to the swimming pool. I only did 50 lengths today. Swimming pool was empty. There was only me and another woman in there, which was quite nice. So went up there and then I cycled to the cinema, stopping off at the Baker's. okay? Because we don't buy food in the cinema. If you know me well, you know that already. We do not buy food in the cinema. I object to paying £8 for a blooming box of popcorn or whatever it is. So I stopped at the baker's on the way there. And I bought a vegetable pasty and a cheese and onion pasty. And I said, oh, I'm taking these into the cinema. And this old bird comes out from the back. She said, what are you going to see? She said, please don't tell me you're going to watch Beauty and the Beast on your own. And I went down. I said, I think we're finished this conversation. And she starts laughing. And I said, well, yeah, I am actually going to see that. She said, oh, do me a favour. Come back and tell me what it's like when you've seen it. I want to take my grandchildren to see it. So I said, OK, I'll do that. So then I went to the cinema and I walked in there. There was no one in the foyer. I mean, no one. There's not even someone selling tickets at on the front desk. You have to go to the popcorn counter to buy the tickets because there's no one there. So I went straight and I said, am I early or has something gone wrong? She said, no. She said, this is normal daytime. Not a soul in there. I said, well, I want to see Beauty and the Beast, please. I said, is it in 2D? She said, 3D ones later. I said, no, I want the 2D one. I said, I have terrible trouble with those 3D films. When they have scenes that are dark, as in lights are dark, you know, as not as in scary or something like that, as in the light is dark, I can't see the bloody screen. And if I go with my mate, he likes to sit down the back. I like to sit sort of front to, you know, the front third of the cinema, somewhere there. So she said, no, it's 2D. So I don't go and see 3D films anymore because I just find them so dark. I don't know if the cinema I'm going to, whether or not they've got a powerful enough projector, perhaps. I don't know. So I said, well, I'll have a ticket then, please. I said, how much is that? So I got me £20 out. She says, £6. I said, oh, that's cheap today. I said, is it always that amount? She said, for this particular time of day, yes. She said, you ever come in at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, it's only £6, sometimes a fiver. Well, you can't go wrong for that, can you? When I've gone on a Saturday night before, you can pay 10, 12, 15 quid. So I thought, I'll push the boat out even further and have a cup of tea as well. So that £6 became £7.90. And I did glance across at the popcorn. I thought, no, you must restrain yourself. You've got two pasties in there. Don't be a greedy boy. No. So I've got into the cinema. Oh no. Why she said? She said, where would you like to sit? So she showed me this little video display unit. And I said, well, what seats are available? She said, all of them. I said, honestly, she said, no, there's eight people in there, including you. So I sat sort of front three rows. Oh, OK. Someone wants to know, what's that in dollars? OK, so £6 would be about $9, which is not bad, is it? $9 to see a film, £6. Not bad at all. So I selected my seat and I went in and I sat, you know, I worked out where the seat was. It was like third row back, first one in the aisle. So I'm sitting there. So I've got my cup of tea and I've put that in the little thing there. And then the trailers have come on. I always quite like to see the trailers, see what you're coming on next. So I've got my pasties and I put those there. Anyway, I opened the, I didn't know which pasty was which. I had a cheese and onion and a vegetable. So I opened this first pasty and it was the cheese one. So, I'll enjoy this. Anyway, I started eating it. The cheese was, I don't know, it tasted like old feet. I mean, I've never sucked or licked an old foot before. Some people are into that sort of thing. I'm sorry, I draw the line at feet, dear. They are dirty, disgusting, filthy things that really should be cut off at birth. We should have our feet removed when we are born. I'm sorry, they are disgusting. Some people like licking feet. What the hell's all that about? Feet licking. And they get their tongue in between people's toes and everything. Oh, no. And what if you've got infected nails? I've got two nails, one on each foot, that constantly get infected for some reason. And you've got to put that little paint on it. You know that paint? You had to buy it. Oh, and you have to do it for months. Twice a day for months and months and months. And eventually, you know, this infection, it's like a whitey stuff. It gradually moves down the now and you get new now behind it. And it takes about 6 months. And then you think it's fixed and it starts all over again. I'm sick of it, dear. Nail infections. Please don't lick people's... How do we get onto the subject of feet? Oh, yes. Yeah, so this cheese, that it just stank of old feet. So I had about half of it. Oh, I didn't want to chuck it away. And then I put that back in a bag and put it on the seat next to me. And then I had the vegetable pasty. I'm still sitting there watching these trailers, sipping away at my tea, and had that as well. And that was nice. And that one was nice. Hang on, let me just write a little note here. Pills. I mustn't forget my pills at 10 o'clock. I have to take pills around 10 o'clock. And I nearly forget the nighttime pills whenever I'm off. I never forget them at work. Sometimes at home, it gets to 10 o'clock and I might be watching the telly or chatting to you and I forget them. So I had that pasty and behind me, just a little bit further up, were sitting five girls, youngish girls, but they were well behaved. They weren't the mouthy type, you know, that you get in Sainsbury's. Pushing the prams. I've got a buggy. Get out of my way. I got a buggy. They weren't like that at all. No, they were nice girls. And I was sitting there watching the film. And then behind those, a little bit further up there, there was an older couple. Not elderly, probably just a little bit older than me. So, and then the film starts. Beauty and the Beast. And I'd really been looking forward to it. And there she was. How'd you say her name? Hermione Granger? Something like that? She's really good. Very, very good indeed. And, of course, you probably know the plot. You know, Ugly Beast and Beautiful Girl fall in love. And you know the rest of the story, of course. There are some little bits that have changed. They seem to have changed a little bit here and there. And there are extra songs. There are extra songs. It really is a very good musical. It's a musical, of course, and I love it. I absolutely loved it. There was the Be Our Guest scene, you know, when they come and do the dinner, and that all works very well. What other wonderful bits? The scenery in it is quite beautiful at times, and they go through the forest. You know, I mean, where I live, it's not too bad here. I'm surrounded by lots of pine trees, but lots of houses. I'd like to live, I think, in a little bungalow, a little like a Hansel and Gretel type house. You know, Hansel and Gretel. I'd love to live in a Hansel and Gretel type cottage or bungalow in the middle of a dark forest. Would you like that? Is that your sort of thing? But of course, that'd be no good to me because my solar panels wouldn't work, would they? There'd be too much shade on the solar panels. So I don't think that would work. Unless, you know, I could have the solar panels slightly outside the forest and then cable the electricity in somehow. That would work, wouldn't it? I'd quite like to live in the middle of a forest. I don't think there's anything really to tell you about the film other than go and see it. 10 out of 10. Absolutely. There were quite a few people going on about, oh, it's Disney's first gay kiss and all that. Well, number one, had there been a kiss, I would have probably, oh, that's just another kiss to me. They're making a big thing about this, as they always do. But there is no gay kiss. There is no gay kiss in there. There is a kind of, there is a really camp, gay, I say camp and gay. Don't always put camp and gay together. My God, I know enough straight blokes who are camper than me. I could name you a list of straight blokes and a member of my family who's really quite camp, but is in no way gay. That's true. I mean, what do they look like? Walking around in pink tracksuits? You know, no, I ain't gay, mate. What, in a pink tracksuit? Are you serious, mate? But there's this really camp one in there. And I suppose that's what they mean by a kind of little bit of a gayness in there. But it works very well and it's very tastefully done. And it's hilarious. He is actually hilarious in it. And at the end of the film, when they're all dancing, that's all I'm going to say to you there. It's quite nice. It's quite nice. It gets with someone. And you see this for about 3 seconds, if that. It's just a quick glance and you think, oh, that was nice. And it's a really lovely, charming film. Go and see it. Beauty and the Beast, out now, boys and girls. And go do it in the daytime. And it's only £6. But if you think there's some sort of gay kiss in it, there's no kiss. There's no kissing in there. The only kissing I've seen in the last few days is people on Periscope go, oh, yeah, hello. Hello, darling. And a little bit like that. Go and see Beauty and the Beast, OK? Let's do some of your messages coming in on this Tuesday night. Hello to Joanna, who says, I must agree, Beauty and the Beast is an excellent movie musical. I loved it. Yeah, Joanna, I'm going to go and see it again, probably sometime at the weekend, because my mate Ronnie is away at the moment. He's in New York. He's coming back, I think tomorrow night he's coming back. He's had a tattoo. Oh, God. Every time he's got arms covered in tattoos. Now, I don't mind a tattoo here and there, you know. But honestly, his entire arms are covered in tattoos. One on the chest. And it's all very well when you're young and reasonably your skin is a little bit supple. But as you get older and the wrinkles, and it all creases up to there, and they look terrible after. And once you've got one, that's it. Look at my skin. Look at my skin. Clean and pristine. Oh, gaze, and there's a few tiny little lines. I was a bit disappointed to suddenly the other day. They asked me how old I am. And I said my age. I said, I'm 54. Oh, wow. You easily pass as 47. I was a bit disappointed at that. I thought you might have said, I'm sort of in my 30s. If I could be any age again, I'd like to be about 32. 32 to 47. Anywhere in between there, I was sort of having a really good time. Out every night. Off me head every weekend. Oh, what a wonderful time. What age would you like to be, incidentally, boys and girls? Yeah, I'm 54. Hello, Chris. How are you? I'm 54. What age would you like to be again? And why? Let us know. Phone lines are open now, boys and girls. You see, that's how I work the show. I've got all sorts of subjects written down here for a possibility for you to call in, OK? But one just dropped into my head while we were chatting away there. So I think that's quite a good thing. What age would you like to be again and why? Tell me tonight. Call in now. Lines are open. Operators are standing by. Hello? You are held in a queue. Your call is important to us and you will soon be connected to a customer services representative. Please hold the line while we try and connect you. Yes. 020 8144 3477 is my phone number tonight, boys and girls. 020 8144 3477. What age would you like to be again and why? I bet there's a few of you in your 40s and 50s who have possibly children or nieces and nephews, but you think, or they think, you'd like to be a teenager again. I bet there's none of you that would want to be a teenager again. Or if there is, call me and tell me why. I'd be very surprised if there is. There's no way I'd want to be a teenager again. Oh, I was spotty and ugly, even uglier than I am now. I was really spotty and I had acne. Great big, and I'd be in that mirror. Oh, another way on the mirror. Disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. And in my 20s, I was even fatter than I am now. I had a little round face and a belly. I used to work at the Black... So I was fat like that and I went to work at the Black Cap in Camden in London. What age would you like to be again and why? 020 8144 3477. Or you can Skype in. My Skype in number is, all one word, United Kingdom Talk. I say Skype number. It's the Skype name. OK, so Skype name, United Kingdom Talk. Or phone number, local London number, 020 8144 3477. Of course, if you don't want to call in, you're happy to just sit there and listen and watch. That's fine as well. Chris says, I wouldn't want to be a teenager today. Oh, my God. Well, you've got to have a knife with you for a start, haven't you? God's sake, they're all carrying knives. What's all that about? Everyone is carrying blooming knives. I'd be scared to go out the door now, wouldn't you? Dear me. No, I'm so glad I'm not a teenager now. I think it would frighten life out of me walking through some of these streets. I've got to say, I walk through Clapham High Street once a week where I work at a place in Clapham. And you know, I was walking from my car this last Thursday. It's Thursday night I do there. So I park the car and I park at one end of the high street. You've got to be very, very careful where you park in Clapham in London, because it's taxes only, and you get a ticket for £120. Oh, it's shocking. Anyways, walking from the car to the pub, which is about a 3-minute walk, believe it or not, it's that far. And as I'm walking down, I'm looking around at these people, and I thought, do you know what? If I'd have come out of London 20 years ago and had just gone back in, I think I'd be scared to walk down here now when you see some of the trash, some of the absolute trash that is walking up and down that road. I mean, it is frightening. It really is frightening. And I think, wasn't there an American politician or something that said there are some no-go areas in London? Wasn't there? Well, I think he's absolutely right. I think there probably are. There's probably worse places than Clapham High Street to walk down at 10 o'clock, 11, 12, 2 o'clock in the morning. If I'd have disappeared from London 20 years ago and come back for that first time, I'd be like, oh my God, what's going on here? I'd be scared. I would be scared. Graham says, Graham, are you off now, Graham? Graham's got to go up and get six to help. Graham. To serve a lovely May & Co. in the press gallery. He's got a wonderful job. Graham works for TM. Yes, he does. That's all I'm saying. Have a nice day, Joe, Graham, all right? Callum says... just a minute. No, you see, I'm reading the most recent messages first. I do get a little bit confused with these messages sometimes. What happens is that I'll be making a comment and then quickly someone will answer that, and then I've moved on, and then they'll answer that one, and then I've moved on, and then when I look back, I've missed half of them, so I can't see. So that's why I don't always read out all your comments, because if they're not making sense, then there's no point in reading them. Kevin wants to know why my mic is sticking up, because it picks me up better from here. Watch. Let's move that out of the way. Now, if I've moved that down there, does that not sound as good, or does it sound exactly the same? All right, so down there, out of the way. And up here a little bit more. I'm sure that probably sounds a little bit better, because the further away it goes, it might sound a little bit echoier, and that's the only thing. Thank you, Kevin. Let's go up. Adam's off to Gran Canaria tomorrow for a little holiday. Oh, I used to go there. I think I went there 3 times, Adam. After that, you've had enough, I think. I know some people like to move to Gran Canaria. I don't know how much the properties are there, but I'm sure you'll have a lovely time, as long as you like drinking. There's a lot of drinking goes on there. You'll be going to that dreadful Yumbo centre, won't you? Which is like a 1960s shopping centre, everyone. Let me tell you, Gran Canaria is a bit of a holiday destination. And they have this shopping centre called the Yumbo Centre, where everyone goes at night time. It's such a dump, it really is. But it's all right, you know, it's all right to have a good laugh. So have a nice time, Adam. Dino says, yes, Periscope, I have not been on for months. It's lost its sparkle. Oh, I tell you what, Dino, download Periscope. Download it and have a look, sort of any time... I think from 10 o'clock, really, and see what sort of stuff's on there. It's just a waste of time. People looking for a hookup for the night. That's all it is. Alan says, I first found you on Periscope, but I don't use it anymore either. And Mark the singer, he was brilliant. Oh, now, which Mark was that? Was that last night, Alan? I can't remember. Oh, talking of singing, I've heard our Eurovision song. Oh, it's ghastly. It's so dreary. I was actually talking to Nikki French, who represented us in 2000 she did, Nikki French, talking to her the other night, and she quite likes it. I think it's awful. It's awful. It's dreary. Not only is it dreary, you can have a dreary song like I Will Always Love You, but you can bring it up with a great big orchestra, can't you? Well, this is a dreary song, but there's no orchestra. It's like just a bit of a string and a bit of a keyboard, and that's about it. So I can't see that doing any good. And there was another bloke tonight who put on the Irish entry, which is, I have to say, is marginally better than ours. But no, I think that's a bit dreary as well. So I don't know. I'm waiting for the Eurovision CD to come out, which I usually buy and download it onto my... well, you don't buy the CD, you know, you buy the download on the Apple... iPhone... what do you call it? the Apple Music Store or something like that, and it's only about 10 quid. So I'll download it onto there and then listen to all of them. But I've only heard two so far. I'm afraid I've only got two so far. They're all counting. Don't count numbers, everyone. 23 million viewers, 22. We're going up and up. Now, we've got drop down again now. What tends to happen when you're doing a show? It goes up, right? Up, and then it starts coming down. And it kind of settles somewhere. And you're there for about 45 minutes. And then people get fed up. I think any more than 45 minutes really is a bit of a waste of time. Only after that are the people that are real staunch followers are still there. And they're the ones that got the mugs when we gave away mugs a few months ago now, didn't we? I left it till right at the end of the show and I said, I've got something for you today. If you want one of our mugs, there's one here, actually. Although this isn't to be given. Oh, hang on. What's that one over there? Oh, no, that's it. One minute. This one here. This is not for giving away. This was actually a slight second. I've actually got a couple that are slight seconds. All right, so here's one. Do you want to see the seconds? I'm not sending any more off because they get broken in the post. I've had a couple get broken in the post. I'm pleased to report Joanna, who's with us tonight, received her. So this is a slight second. And if you've got one of these mugs, you can see that this is like a matte finish, whereas all the others are gloss. And I didn't like this. It's my sister that actually printed these off. This is like a mat, and I wasn't keen on this, so I didn't have these ones done. Oh, incidentally, we were talking about... Let me just put that back in there. Do you want to see the other seconds ones I've got? Hang on a minute. I think it's that one down here. I think I've got three. Oh, there they are. One minute. I'll tell you what. If anyone wants one of these, I'm not sending them off anymore. Okay, and if you come into one of our karaoke nights or quiz nights, you can have one of these. Right, here we go. Let's have a look. Now, that's what I was saying. I mentioned the other day, I was considering this year, and it's usually around Christmas we do a little bit of a giveaway. I was considering this year doing mouse mats. Now, years and years and years and years ago, I did do mouse mats. And I mentioned this to my sister. She said, I can look into it for you. But does anyone use mouse mats anymore? I mean, I don't. Do you? Does anyone still use mouse mats? I mean, this is just on the desk and it seems to work okay, all my little bits and pieces here. So I don't know. Oh, I've got hiccups now. So that's my, I don't think anyone uses mouse mats anymore. So maybe not. Maybe T-shirts. Maybe T-shirts. We'll do something like T-shirts or something like that again. Okay, so here are the mugs that were rejected, boys and girls, that by our maker, my sister Sharon, my lovely, lovely sister Sharon. Here's one of them. I don't see what's wrong with this, actually. She checks these, and if she's not happy, then she rejects them. But she's given me the ones that she's rejected. So I don't see that there's anything wrong with that at all. Okay, so there's one. So we have a look at the other two. We ought to do some news stories instead of giving away mugs like this. 1 minute. How do they go in the box? That's it. They only go in the box one way. I'm not sending them through the post anymore because they just get broken. Right? So that's that one. 1 minute. Another one here. I can't find anything wrong with them. Is she sure there's anything wrong with these? What's wrong with these then? There's nothing wrong with these. I say that, you know, don't be coming to collect one of these and then making a hot cup of tea and the handle falls off. You know? Poor Glenda, hers arrived at her house broken, but she's going to get her husband to glue it back to brother, I think. Isn't that right, Glenda? So that's, I don't think there's anything wrong. I don't see anything wrong. I don't know why my sister rejected these, but they seem all right to me. What's wrong with this one then? I honestly can't see anything wrong with them. Oh, I see. Yeah, so that one, I see what's happening. The picture is slightly crooked, but you would never notice that. She's a bit of a perfectionist, my sister, a little bit like myself. I'm not really. What, doing this? Do I look like a perfectionist? That's why I'm not on the telly, dear. So we've got three of those. If you want one of those, let me know. And it's the first three people that that let me know. And I'll put them aside. And if you turn up at one of the karaoke nights, I'll bring one down to you, OK? Let's see if anyone wants one now. Is anyone going to ask for it? Joanna, I still do what, darling? Oh, okay. So people do still use mouse mats. Look, Joanna, you... Hello, Paul. No tea or coffee. Good idea. No tea. Do you want one, Paul? Do you want one of those? Do you want to get your lips around my face, darling? While you're drinking a cup of tea with it? Hold it with both hands, though, in case the handle comes off. James Clark. Okay, I'll put your... You want one of these, Joe? Can you put... Can I have a mug? First three people to say that, then I'll put them in my car, and next time I see you, you can have one, all right? But come... I mean, don't make me drive the bloody thing around for months on end, though, will you, please? Right, Paul Dow. Okay, one's yours. Let's put your name on that. One for Paul. There's one gone. Next one. Come on, chop, chop. Anne says, I still use a mouse mat. Oh, okay. So you do. Okay, yep, you're one for you, Paul. Rachel's already got one, of course. Anne says, I still use a mouse mat. Okay. James says, meet you at Fleet Services. That's miles away, James. I never go to Fleet Services. I never go to Fleet Services. What? Johnny Key says, hello, what's going on here? Oh, we're just having a bit of a chat today. Thank you very much. James says, eBay them, I'll bid. What do you reckon we'll get for a mug? About 5p. We'll probably get 5p like that. Anne says she'd love to be 25 again when chocolate didn't sit on my hips. Oh, I don't. I looked at a bar of chocolate 4 years ago and put on a stone. I only looked at it. Terrible, really, isn't it? Terrible. Who else wants one? James says, okay, James Clark. James, you got one, you got 4 weeks to collect it, okay? I've put your name on here. I've put your name on there, okay? You've got only 4 weeks to collect it, otherwise it'll go someone else. I'm not driving these around forevermore. Who wants the other one? Come on, chop, chop. Quickly now, chop, chop. Who wants the other one? Thank you. Mari's got her mug. She's down in Cornwall, Devon, somewhere down there, southwest. Southwest. You get a lot of floods down there, I think, don't you? Eh? Yeah, okay. Good. Now, what have we got to talk? Here's something for you to talk about. Okay, Adam, is Adam still with us? I don't know if Adam's still with us. Could you call in? Because I'd dearly love to go and get a glass of water. And you, I know you can, unless I play my music. Could I play my music for a second or two? Do you mind? I'm desperate for a glass of water here. And I've got to go downstairs. Hopefully the cat won't have made a mess. Oh, don't. I got in last night and she's made a mess again. If you've been following the All About My Cat, I've got an elderly cat. She's about 18 now, and she's very incontinent, and she's not using the litter tray at all now. Unfortunately, I've got half of the kitchen floor covered in newspaper, and last night I came in, she hadn't even gone on that, and what she'd done is gone number twos on the floor and walked round and round and round. And you open the door, and it must have been only recent because the smell hit you. It's just awful. And so I cleaned that up, and out. And it was this 1:30 in the morning, so I've cleaned that up, got the mop and bucket out again. And of course, it had been down there for a while, so it was all sticky on the floor. And you've got to put water on the floor, and then kind of leave it for a while so it soaks in and releases it a bit. Oh dear! So that's it. What I've done now, actually. And it's not a tiny kitchen, but it's not massive. It's big enough, you know. It's kind of a lounge. But if you're wondering who that is coughing, it's Adam. I've picked up his call and I'm just waiting to come to you, Adam. All right, dear. And so what I've done now is use a couple of old pictures, large pictures like that, actually, but larger. A couple of large, not the one that was up there, a couple of old large pictures that I don't use anymore. And I've kind of halved the kitchen. There's like a worktop that comes out like this from one side and then the wall. So I've put these pictures across there. So I've now restricted her to half of the kitchen, which I don't think that's very cruel, really. I mean, she spends most of her time asleep or walking around on a little footstool next to the radiator or walking around in circles. That's all she does now. She don't want to go out. If I take her out to the back garden, which is quite safe, you know, I'm surrounded by a wooden fence and all that. It's not like there's other animals or cats or things coming in there. If I put her out there, she starts meow, meow, meow and walks straight back indoors. So I don't think it's... Do you think that's all right? What do you think, Adam? Do you think that's all right?
I think so. As long as she's not in pain, Chris, that's the main thing.
No.
She obviously isn't.
I don't think she's in pain. I've now restricted her to half the kitchen because, honestly, the mess, it just... And I can't do...
Oh, yeah, imagine.
It's such a mess. And the funny thing is, I'm talking to other people about this who have had pets, and they said they've all gone through this. Towards the end, they seem to lose the power to hold in, you know, their waste material.
It's old age, like anybody, you know, with old age. Yeah. I mean,
that's what's happened.
I don't know if Claire's watching tonight, but obviously Claire has a few cats, and she does voluntary work for the Cats Protection League.
Yes.
So, you know, so she may be able to answer that, but I've certainly had cats getting old, and you just have to sort of...
Is that the first cat you've got now, is it? Or have you had cats that have come and gone?
Afro's not the first one. The very first cat I had was...
Adam,
when I was
Adam,
a, yeah.
While you're telling that story, let me go downstairs. Tell us about your first cat. I'll be 2 minutes, all right?
Okay.
You carry on chatting.
Right. So the first cat I had was when I was about... I suppose about 7 or 8 years old, and the cat's name was Char-Char, and it was a tabby cat. Got her when I was about 7 or 8 years old, and she lived up to the ripe old age of about 18. Yeah, about 18 years old, I think it was, she lived up to. And basically what happened was she got kidney failure in the end, so she had to be put to sleep, which was very sad for me. But a couple of things that she used to do was go around in circles like Katie does. That was one of the problems that she had. And then after Char-Char passed away, I got my next cat, which was called Tom. Again, another tabby cat. And he lived till he was 11 years old. So he was a lovely little Tom cat. And then after that, I had a little kitten called Pud. And unfortunately, Pud only survived 9 weeks. After I got Pud from the... where did I get Pud? Let me see. I got Pud from a advert in the newspaper. I think I paid £10 for him, and he was 8 weeks old. And shortly after I got him, he caught a cold of some description. I'm not quite sure what it was, and unfortunately passed away from it. So that was Pud. After I got Pud, I had after Pud, I had Sox, was my next cat. Now Sox was a half Persian cat, and a friend of mine, Andrew, used to breed cats and dogs, and he gave me... I actually watched Sox being born when she was... I actually watched her being born. And she lived until she was... Let's see. Now, let me think back. Sox was only 7 years old, unfortunately. She had a heart attack. Because half Persians have problems sometimes with their noses, breathing... And also, she unfortunately passed away with a heart failure. That was unfortunate with her. And now I have Afro. Afro is now 12 years old. And
why is it called Afro? Why is it called Afro? Has he got ears sticking up or something?
Right. The reason he's called Afro is this. When I was with my last partner, he already had a cat called Buttons.
We got
a cat together called Zeus. Now, because my partner liked all the Greek names, it was going to be Zeus and Aphrodite. Well, we got Afro, and after we got Afro, I'll tell you the story about how we got him in a minute, actually. We got Afro, and basically he... we got Afro from a place in Brighton, and basically we were going to call him Aphrodite, but then we noticed after a while that he's a boy. So my partner said to me at the time, what can we call him? Or what can we call him? We can't call him Aphrodite. And I said, well, just shorten it to Afro. He's got a
What is Aphrodite? Is that a Greek god or something like that? Is it or a
Greek
plant?
Goddess, yeah, I can't remember.
Oh, it is, yeah. Okay,
he was all into his Greek mythology, so it was all the different Greek mythology. Unfortunately, Zeus had to be rehomed because he actually got depression.
What, the cat did?
The cat got depression.
How could you tell that? I'm sorry, I shouldn't laugh.
Well, no, it's all right. No, we took him because he kept on biting his fur and pulling all his fur out. He kept on pulling all his fur out, and we couldn't work out why he was doing it. So we took him to the vet, and the vet said, no, there's no skin problems there, there's no problems. Do you have other cats in the house? And it's like, yeah. He said, he's got depression. Sorry. So they gave him antidepressants.
Right.
They gave him cat antidepressants, which we ate each other.
I didn't know there was such a thing.
Yeah, but believe so. Wow. What I was told at the time. And also he got a
urinary infection.
Yeah, so he had to be, which is crystallisation, and he had to have tablets for that.
Right.
So obviously, in the end, we decided to rehome him with a little old lady because he didn't like to be with other cats, and it was very heartbreaking getting rid of him.
Of course.
We'd already had him sort of 4 years.
Yeah.
And basically rehomed him with this lady, and within 5 weeks of him being with her, he had a full coat of hair again. Absolutely lovely, and it was very loving to the lady, so that's good, because she'd previously lost a cat.
Yeah.
And wasn't going to get another one, because we all say, oh, I'll never get another cat again after,
after
they pass away.
We do.
But we always do, you know, I mean, some people resist, you know.
Well, I've said that I wouldn't get, I've had three, actually, yeah. I didn't ever buy a cat.
No.
The first one, Tiny, that was a visit from my, that was a gift from my son for my birthday. So I would be in about, I think I would have been about 22 or 23 when I got her. And he was, he was only like, you know, I think he was about 5 or 6 years old. I was in contact with him at that point. He's 32 now, my son. And then there was JD.
Yep.
Now, JD was... Now, whose cat was that? It was another one that I took in from someone else. And then when my mother died in 2000, that's where Katie came from. So she is getting on now, yeah. But I honestly can't see myself having another cat. It's just great heartache when they start becoming ill.
Oh, it is. I mean, I still think about socks. I was just explaining why you were getting your water. I just sort of went through the family of cats that I've had over the years. And, I mean, Afro is going to be the hardest for me. But I had a cat previously called Sox. And she was half Persian. She was black with four white paws, obviously. And I woke up one morning and Buttons, the cat who I was just explaining about, was staring into the room where the cat slept. And he would not move. And I went, morning, Buttons. And he would normally look up and go meow. And he didn't. And I thought, that's so strange. I went, morning, Buttons. And still no reaction, still staring. Anyway, I've looked through the hole, and there's poor old Sox dead on the floor. She had a heart attack during the night. So, unfortunately, she passed away rather suddenly and totally unexpected. So that was unfortunate. But Afro is now 12 years old.
I mean, my first cat, Tiny, that was, you know, I got up, and she'd been ill for some time, and I didn't want to take her to the vet because I thought I knew what would happen. And I got up one, it was a Sunday morning, and I got up and went into the kitchen, and she was laying on her side, just quivering, but, you know, like she'd had a stroke or something like that. Anyway, I took her straight into the vet, and who were very good, but they said... we can try and bring her back, but we might not succeed. We're not sure what will happen, and she'd go through a lot of suffering if we try. So I said, no, you let her go, and that's fine. My other cat, I'm afraid that's not very nice. The other cat, she was found with her head missing, around the back. I think it was a dog. one of those dogs or something, which actually, you know, at first I thought some kids, because she was extremely friendly, she'd go to anyone, you know, all you ever got, come on, you know, and she'd come over. And I thought some kids had got hold of her, you know, you think the worst thing and thought it was funny to cut a cat's head off. But that while I was round the back, because some boy came up, I called the, because I thought it was dodgy, I called the police as well. And a lovely police lady came, and she came, and we're standing by that. And then some awful woman come up while we were standing over. You're going to move that? I don't want my kids to see that. You're going to move that? Oh, dreadful woman. And we just looked at her, at which point a boy came over and said, oh, I saw what happened. And a policeman said, oh, what happened? He said, and he said it was a dog that got hold of it and like that, and it's ripped its head off. Which actually, when I'd heard that the dog had done it, I don't mean this to be nasty, but it felt better, because that's a natural thing with dogs and cats, isn't it?
Yes, of course, yeah. I don't understand what's going on in the news as well with the cats.
Dreadful.
That's been going on for 20-odd years, because it was a phone-in programme.
Is this Croydon? Croydon, isn't it?
It's actually all over.
Oh, right.
If you actually study the history on it, which I've sort of been looking up and what have you, there was actually a programme on BBC Radio London. They were covering the story, but it seems to have gone very quiet, thank goodness, at the moment. It doesn't seem to be so many. It sort of had a hype. But people were phoning in, going back sort of 15, 20 years with exactly the same telltale signs of what's been happening to these poor cats. You know, it keeps repeating itself, and the stories were actually going back nearly 10 years.
Yeah,
some people say, oh, this happened to my cat in Hertfordshire 10 years ago, and it's exactly the same as what's happening now. And the police and there's a charity in Norwood near Croydon.
Yeah.
They're actually offering rewards, and they're sort of taking all the bodies and trying to work out what's been going on.
What is wrong with people that do this sort of stuff? And we keep seeing these videos pop up in national newspapers of people like doing things like drop kicking kittens and what the hell's all that about, eh?
I just won't watch these videos anymore, because I've seen too many of them. They're just too upsetting to watch. I just remove them from my page when people post on there now.
On a similar subject, factory farming's no better. I mean, you watch some of those abattoirs and factory farming. That's no better. You know, you can't say you're an animal lover and then not watch that. Most people would say to you, and I've come across this quite a few times, when I don't want to go a hot long the animal thing today, but just to say, when you say to people, well, watch this video, and their general answer is, I don't want to know. You know, and they won't watch it, because they know once they've watched one of those videos, they never go near a piece of lamb again.
I have watched videos, and it's just purely and simply they give me nightmares.
So I just leave it at that because I don't really want to do that one tonight. Adam.
No, that's it.
Anyway, so you're up tomorrow. You're up early tomorrow, aren't you?
Yes, I'm up at. I've got to be there at 7:40. 7:40.
Where's that, Gatwick?
So I've worked it 2 hours beforehand.
Is that Gatwick?
Traveling as well.
Is that Gatwick?
About 4. Gatwick, yes.
Yep. Okay. What time are you getting there then? 7:06, 5:43, 4. About 4 o'clock.
Probably about 4:30. I've worked it out. I mean, checking. They said 4. Because as you know, Chris, I don't get to go on that many holidays, so this is actually probably only the fifth time I've ever flown.
Okay.
So if I can ask nicely.
Oh, yes.
If any of your viewers can give me any tips on flying and what to do when I get to Gran Canaria and places to go.
Are you scared of flying?
Not at all. I absolutely love it. I've deliberately booked window seats there and back.
Oh, fab. Yeah, fab.
Because that to me is part of the holiday experience. I
mean, is it 4 hours?
4 hours, 10 minutes, yeah.
Oh, that's all right. That'd be fine, that will. That'd be fine. It's always quite good. I don't think you'd get scared. But sometimes when there's turbulence and that, and women and children start screaming, I always find that hilarious.
I do as well.
They're screaming and I'm laughing my head off. Aren't we terrible, dear?
We are. But there's free Wi-Fi, apparently, so I might be able to do a Facebook Live.
What, on the plane?
Yeah.
What airline's that, then?
Norwegian.
Well, how does that work?
I don't know, but it says on my itinerary, it says, you know, meals, what seat I'm in, and then it says free Wi-Fi, and I'm thinking, well, I didn't think you could get free Wi-Fi on,
Hang on a minute.
An aeroplane.
I didn't know that. Hang on a minute. How does...
Have a Google.
Here we go. In the Telegraph. Oh, the Telegraph. We've gone very upmarket now. Here we go. For all its woes, air travellers offered... Now, when was this? Oh, this was this year. A precious few hours away from the squall of emails. In-flight Wi-Fi is getting faster and cheaper and is an increasingly common offering on budget and flagship airlines. There you go. Sorry, I missed your email. Was on the plane. Is no longer an excuse. How does it work? Right. There are two ways for an internet signal to reach your device. The first is via ground-based mobile broadband. Well, I can't see that. You're like 2 miles up in the sky, aren't you? Which sends signals up to an aircraft's antennas, usually on the base of the plane. As you travel into different sections of airspace, the plane automatically connects to signals from the nearest tower. Oh, so it's the same as mobile phone, that is. Yeah. So there is, in theory, no interruption to your browsing. But if you're passing over large bodies of water... or particularly remote terrain, it can be an issue. The second method uses satellite. Planes connect to satellites in geostationary orbit, 35,786 kilometres above the planet, which send and receive signals to the Earth via receivers and transmitters. Ah, they're the same satellites that are used in television, weather, and military. Information is transmitted to and from your smartphone via an antenna on top of the aircraft. Oh, well, that would be very, very interesting to see how well... Ah, hang on. Why is in-flight Wi-Fi slow? Technology is developing, but it's a struggle to keep up with the sophistication and sheer numbers of Wi-Fi users. Ah, so it might be slow. Oh, hang on a minute. No. These days, a satellite connection offers around 12 megs. Well, that would be fast enough. Yeah. Here we are. Look. Airlines. Emirates, Qatar. Is it Qatar, Qatar, Qatar? How'd you say it? Qatar. 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 No, it's one of the Arabian ones, isn't it? Qatar. Oh, yeah. JetBlue. Yeah. Norwegian. That's your one. Turkish. Yeah. Air China. Look, I mean, isn't it a joke? You're Nokia, China, Air China, Turkish Airways, Norway. All these tiny airlines, not on British Airways, not on Virgin. No. I mean, what a joke. What a joke that is. So that'd be very interesting to see how that works. You're on iPhone, aren't you?
Yes, I am, yes.
All right, so 7, 8, 9, 10. Can you try and give me a FaceTime at 10 o'clock?
At 10 o'clock? Yes, I will, yeah.
10 o'clock in the morning. We'll see if that works. How exciting is that? Will we be having Adam the Singing Plumber on the plane?
Yes, with the steward backing. I'll see if I can do a Facebook Live in the morning when I'm.
I think that's an excellent idea. That is an excellent idea, Adam. Well, thank you for filling in. I've had my pills and I've got my glass of water now.
Lovely.
So right, I'm happy.
I'm off to bed now, so I'll have to watch the rest of the show on the aeroplane tomorrow morning.
All right, sweet dreams. Can you leave your device on though? Because we can't really afford to lose a million listeners at the moment.
No, exactly. No, I'll keep
cheering. Cheerio, Adam. Thanks, darling.
Cheers, Chris.
Bye-bye now. There we are. Another man off on holiday tomorrow. Oh, dear me. Lots of your messages coming through. Thank you very much for that. Adam's off tomorrow morning, marketer. I think he's going to probably be leaving his house around about 3:15 in the morning. I hate that, don't you? This is one of the reasons I hate flying. I can't bear that. Mucking around at airports at 3, got to be there at 3 o'clock in the morning and all that. Oh, God, hear me. Hello to Shania on the Isle of Wight, who's with us today. Shania is in the house. Good evening to Lee Cobby. Evening, Lee. Anne says, Adam, as soon as you land, start getting drunk. Oh, we won't. He doesn't drink. Adam is the same as me. He doesn't drink. He used to be, you won't mind me telling you, he used to be actually addicted to Coca-Cola. Which is where his he's not anymore, but he had an enormous weight a few months ago, which was caused by drinking Coca-Cola. He was addicted to Coca-Cola, and he told me he was drinking about 4 or 5 liters a day. I mean, gosh, I mean, I can just about get through one glass. After a glass of Coca-Cola, my teeth feel like they're about to fall out. Dreadful. These are all mine. Look, all my teeth they are. Paul wants to say, why do cats poo in other people's gardens? Well, because they don't like to dirty their own one. Stupid question, Paul. I thought that would be quite easy to work out the answer to that one. Even I don't often use my own toilet. I like to use other people's toilets, you know, so I don't dirty my own one. Anne says, my dog is scared of my neighbour's cat. Actually, in fights, Anne, as you well know, cats often come off better than the dogs. They cling on. If they can get the right, they cling on to their nose like that. And the poor dog goes away, doesn't it? Leon Corrigan's with us today. Hello, Leon. Leon, all right? Mari says, I'm having a cup of tea in my Copa mug. Good. You enjoy that cup of tea. I'll be having a cup of tea later on. Joanna says, I'm allergic to cats. I have dogs all my loves. I'm allergic to my cat. Always have been. If I pick her up and I cuddle her, I have to wash my hands and face very quickly. Otherwise, it all comes up. And on my hands, if she like digs her claws in, you know, to hold on, they come up in big white bumps. And I have to wash them very quickly. Paul says he's allergic to pussies as well. Well, I think we all know that, dear. Anne says her cat was called Mishka. Mishka. That's a nice name for a cat. Rachel says, one thing most of us fur parents have to face. Hard to do, but we know we have to do it when they're suffering. I know what you mean. My cat was called Puss Puss. Puss Puss. Puss Puss. And of course, you remember Mrs. Slocum's pussy. She had a pussy as well that she often liked to talk about. Mark says, I once had to have my dog put down. I didn't want to watch. No, you don't have to watch. You never have to watch that sort of thing. Joanna says, it's so hard to put down a pet, Adam. They do become our children. They absolutely do become our children, our little cats, don't we? And for, of course, years, they do keep us company for years and years and years. But then we get to the end and it's just the same as losing a person, isn't it? Maybe not so much as losing a parent or a child. Well, worst, I think that one of the worst things you lose is a child. You know, I've known a few people over time to lose children. My Auntie Brenda lost her son. He had Crohn's disease. And he would have to keep going into hospital every now and again to have a bit more cut out, you know, operation-wise. And eventually he came to the conclusion he didn't want to go and into the hospital anymore and have any more operations. So I think they put them in on some sort of steroid treatment. And he got a brain hemorrhage caused by the steroids and that done him in. But he wasn't that old at the time. And it must be just dreadful to lose a child. You know, that's the worst thing, isn't it? Joanna says, yes, Mrs. Slocum always talked about her pussy. Yes, she did. Yes, she did. Absolutely, she did. Thank you very much. All right. Now, here's something else for you to think about. We were talking about pets dying. And we're talking about, you know, members of the family dying, that sort of thing. What about you? Ever thought about your death? Let's put a little humorous angle on this, shall we? If you can. This was in the Daily Mail a few days ago, actually. They say that laughter is the best medicine. So it's perhaps fitting that humour is the personality trait most British people want to be remembered for when they die. Now, I gotta say, this goes for me as well. I want to be remembered when I go for perhaps bringing a smile to people's faces now and then. Maybe make them think a little bit more. I'd love to be remembered. Oh yeah, that was Chris. He used to do this karaoke night, quiz night, video show. And he did make a smile now and again. Not all the time. It's not a comedy programme, you know. But if I could be remembered for my sense of humour, I'd be very happy with that, I think. Levity and amusement are top of the lists of characteristics most desired to define us in death. The finding comes after terminal illness charity Mary Curie, who do wonderful, wonderful work. Marie Curie. Marie Curie nurses. You know, if you've got some sort of terminal illness, they come in and they just try and bring you up. What a wonderful people they are. And I think you've got to be a certain sort of person to be able to look after other people. I've known people give up careers to look after their sick parents. I don't think I could have done that. I think it takes a very, very special person. And if you're one of those, if you're a person that gave something up to look after a sick parent or a sick child or you know, a sick friend, whatever, then you are a very, very special person. And you're much better than most of us if you've been able to do that. I think it's a wonderful thing. I think very few people can actually do that. We just can't cope. You know, I've got an elderly cat down there who keeps mucking up on the floor. And sometimes I lose my temper a bit with her. I mean, I don't start throwing her around the kitchen, but I might shout at her. And then after you've done that, you feel so bad. And you think, why on earth did you shout at that sick animal? You don't mean to do it. I don't know what comes up. Oh, and last night, you know, I came in and the mess all over the floor. Oh, God's sake, Katie, why did you do that? And she starts walking around in circles again. But we don't mean to do that. But there are people who don't lose their rag, like the Marie Curie nurses. They will come in and they will just be kind and nice. How wonderful to just be like that. And never lose your rag, no matter what happens if someone's sick, you know. People get so sick, they're just like my cat. You know, they lose all their control. That happened to my uncle. He had a brain tumour. And that's Auntie Brenda's husband who died a few years ago. Now, he had a brain tumour and he lost control down there, you know. And the Marie Curie nurses, they don't complain. They come in. How wonderful to be like that. Anyway, it goes after, it says, the finding comes after terminal illness charity Marie Curie quizzed 845 of the people as part of their annual Great Daffodil Appeal, where they collect money and all that. 36% prioritised humour over every other trait, while two-fifths said they want to be known for how caring they were, which is exactly what I just said. Fittingly, some 41% said their most enduring memories of loved ones included their jokes, smiles and laughs, the survey found. Happy memories were also considered crucial to helping people overcome the sadness of losing a loved one. 82% of people also said their positive memories helped them deal with their loss. But 35% of them said their happy memories of loved ones were tainted by the poor end of life care they received. And we've seen this on the television, haven't we? In terribly run care homes. People actually hitting the elderly people they're supposed to be laughing at. And have you seen how much it costs to stay in some of these places? Thousands, more than £1,000 a week. Where does anyone, how did it get to that? How is it £1,000 a week to look after someone? I'd like to see the profits of some of these care homes. I really would. 20% said better end-of-life care would have helped them to preserve memories of their loved ones. And again, another aunt of mine, Auntie Renee, she had a brother who passed away last year. And she used to go and visit him at the care home and she would say, I wish he'd come out of there. She said, it's a terrible place, the way they're spoken to and all that. It's sad to see so many people feeling that their lasting memories have been tainted by the poor care that their loved ones had received at an important and precious time. When you lose someone close to you, it can be overwhelming and potentially traumatic experience. But the right care and place can also be peaceful and as calm as possible. So that's the whole story there. But I want to ask you, when you go, what do you want to be remembered for? I'd like, as I say, to be remembered by perhaps bringing a smile to people's faces. No matter what I'd been doing, whether it was DJing at the Black Cab on a Monday night or having a chat to you like we are tonight. That's how I'd like to be remembered. Bit of a sense of humour, you know. We won't have any of that. Oh, he's quite funny, but some of his jokes are a little bit politically incorrect. I'm not interested in political correctness. What I'm interested in is putting a smile on some people's faces. So how do you want to be remembered? Perhaps you'd like to tell me tonight. You can call in 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. Lines are open, 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in on our Skype in number, United Kingdom Talk. Is the Skype in name, okay? Skype in name is United Kingdom Talk, or call in 020-8144-3477. Rachel says, Macmillan nurses are amazing. I agree. It takes a special sort of person to be a carer. And you can give up your job and you can spend years, years and years looking after someone. If you can do that, wow, you know, you're very, very special. Lee says, I used to be a carer with people who had dementia and I had to wash them in their bed. People were bedbound and had to feed them and also wash them after they died before undertakers collected them. Well, you're a special person, Lee. I don't think if you're good at that, was that a job for you, Lee? Was that a job? I don't think if you're, you know, if you're really good at it, I don't think it's just a job. It's a little bit like nurses, isn't it? I mean, that's more of a, can't think of the word now, you know, where you want to be doing something to. It's like a, oh gosh, what's that word now? I always lose words, don't I? It's a, someone tell me the word. You know the word I mean, don't you? When you want to be doing something to help people, what's that called? Someone to tell me. Anyway. Joanna says, I've often thought about mine, and that's why I prepared my own funeral to take away from my loved ones and have to do. Yeah, that's cool. Anne says she lost her horse last year. I didn't know you had a horse, Anne. Wow. That's something else. My sister always wanted a horse. She'd love us. And actually, I think her garden's big enough to have one, to be honest. Mind you, if I moved up to Lincolnshire, which is possible, I mean it's possible. If I ever moved up to Lincolnshire, I was looking at the houses up there the other day, and I think I told you, you know, what I could get up there and not even spend half of what this is worth. Just for the simple, I'm not in any way special. It's only an ex-council three-bedroom house I live in, but I'm down south. You know, I could have a paddock up there, several horses roaming around. Oh, I couldn't be doing all that work, mucking them out and all that business. Although, isn't it funny? Horse poo doesn't smell that bad, does it? It's certainly not as bad as cat poo or dog. Oh, isn't it vile? Mark says he's going on holiday to Ireland soon. Oh, wow. And do you know, I've never been to Ireland. Isn't that mad? I've never actually been to Ireland. Hello, Matt Joplin. Matt Joplin's with us. Privilege is not the word I'm looking for. No. No. It's a... oh, God. What is it called when you give everything up to do something? I think it is... or you feel called to do that job. Rod says, at my age, I'm making my affairs are in order, so those left have not much to worry about. I would like to be known also as being funny, also telling stories about my life. Yeah, that would be excellent as well, wouldn't it? I mean, that would really be excellent, doing something like that. It would. Vocation. Thank you, Anne. The word is vocation. It's their vocation. Well done. Anne, you're becoming very useful on this show. You always manage to sort out if we got a problem here, there or everywhere, don't you? Well done, Anne. Thank you, Anne. Oh, dear. Good. So, right, I think we're going to wrap up now, boys and girls. Let me see. Is there anything else to tell you today? Done that. I've got to do, after I finish the show today, I'm going to do some paperwork. I've got my tax year is coming up to its end. Any more messages, get them in nice and quickly, boys and girls, and I'll read them out before I go. I'll just do the birthdays in a second. I'm going to do some paperwork when I finish the show. I'll probably have a cup of tea when I finish the show in a few minutes' time, and I've got to do some paperwork. My tax year finishes at the end of this month. So what I have to do is get all my papers together, all my receipts. What I do, look, I'll show you what I do, look. See these envelopes? They're receipts. So everything I spend out, I have to tell to do with my business, or the little property thing I do. I've got this. So here's my February receipts there. Everything I've spent out, petrol, mobile phone, internet connection, buying karaoke CDs, all that. I have to print out the receipt, paper, everything. Paper, ink, pens, batteries. You print out a receipt, all goes in there because that comes off my tax. And I've got one for the property as well there. So each month has its own little envelope and I put those in there. And then on the computer, I've got a program that I type in my incoming. So you know, working last night, Central Station, Monday night, then I put the amount in and it saves it on the computer and also on the computer with the receipts. So I might do petrol, what's the date? 21st of March, 2017, £52. And you put that in. And then at the end, what I used to do, I mucked it up last year. What I would do, because I thought I was making it easier, because I have an accountant as well. You need an accountant if you're self-employed. Because I tell you what, if you don't, you will be losing out. Because they know what you can claim for and what you can't. And it's very likely that you won't put everything through. And then here say, hang on a minute, you haven't put the car through or something like that. The car, all included. All tax items, tax deductible items, okay? So you put all that through. And then I send it all off to him. Well, over the years, what I've done is split it up into three piles. Expenses, income, and... Oh, sorry, no. I've split it up through income, revenue expense and capital expense. Revenue expense is stuff that you keep buying, like paper, pens, bills, that sort of thing. Capital expense is when you buy one big item. Not like a car. Well, it would be a car. It depends how you buy it. I have mine on PCP or PEP, I think it's called, something like that. So that goes on that. Capital expense would be like speakers or microphone, something like that, yeah? So I used to split it up. But I sent the stuff off last year and it was a few thousand pounds out. And we couldn't work it out. So what I did then is instead of trying to split it up, I sent him the whole thing as like one long list. I say one lot, you know, on lots of bits of paper, and he found out where the problem is. So in future, I'm going to do that and just send him the whole lot. Rather, you know, I'm trying to make it easy for him. I actually made it a lot harder. So it's better off to send the whole thing off. And I'm going to start working on that so it can go off nice and early. You don't actually have to do this until December. I think it's December. Or is it January? Something like that. But I like to, as soon as March has finished, I usually have all the paperwork with him within 2 weeks. And then what he does, he starts looking through it. And if there's statements missing, he tells me, oh, you haven't got your bank statement for August 2016. And he sent me that. And then I have to contact the bank and say, can you send me that again? And that's all okay. And basically he looks for mistakes and things like that. Because you want him to find the mistake before it goes to the tax people. Because if they find mistakes, you can get fines. So they are worth their weight in gold, really, accountants. It is quite expensive to have an accountant, depending on how much he's doing. Of course, I've got the properties as well as my DJing, quiz nights and karaoke work. So he has to do quite a lot for me. But, you know, that they are worth their weight in gold. I'd probably be paying loads and loads more in tax if it wasn't for the accountant. And it all has to be legitimate, and he sees what's been earned. And if he sees something, oh, weren't you working on this date? He will say to me, oh, you haven't got a date here. You weren't. Why haven't you put down for that Monday? And I'll be able to look through my diary, my little diary, and it will tell me, you know, oh, I was on holiday that day. Okay, so he checks all that for me. Because you don't want the tax people coming back to you and saying, oh, you've made a mistake here, so we're going to fine you. You don't want any of that business going on. So they are worth their weight in gold. So I'm going to start working on that today. Also, I took a bit of a risk, actually, because I hung some washing up just before I came to chat to you today. And I just looked at the weather and it says it's going to rain at 10 o'clock. Well, it's 10:30 now. So I'm hoping by the time I'm hoping by the time I finish the show that it hasn't yet started raining. Otherwise, I shall have very wet duvet covers and sheets and that sort of thing. Just terrible. Oh, talking to duvets and things, you know, you said heard me yesterday. I told you I'd now have two mattress toppers on. I've got my old one on, or I had it. I put my old one on there underneath. That was the one where the little feathers kept sticking through the top because it was only a cheap one. And my John Lewis mattress topper on top of that. That one has got a special thing on and the feathers don't stick through. And I thought that would be extra lovely and soft. Well, I put it on Monday and I haven't been able to sleep well since. Because it's very high. I mean, you almost needed a ladder to get into the bed. But it is very high, this double mattress topper. And the thing is, you get in it and kind of you sink in so far that the corners come round. So, and I couldn't get comfortable. In fact, I got a bad neck the other night. So I've taken the second one back off now. So I'm now with my original John Lewis mattress topper, which is now on my bed. And I had a little sleep this afternoon. And that's all well and good now. I'll be honest, I came back from the cinema after seeing Beauty and the Beast. That was about, I got back about 2:30. I had Angel Delight. And then I went to bed. So that was quite nice, and I slept, and I woke up about, I wanted to wake up by 7. Well, I actually woke back up at about 5:45. I was laying in the bed, and I put the telly on, and I'm just flicking through the news channels, because that Irish bloke's died, isn't he? Is it McGuinness, the McGuinness bloke? So I was watching that on the telly, and I thought, oh, it's lovely. Do you know, I don't want to get up. But I can't, I always think it's, I don't like that laying in bed doing that. I mean, we're a long time dead, aren't we? We are a long time dead. And I don't go along with all this laying in bed all day long. And people have these duvet... I mean, what's all that about? A duvet day? Well, you just lay around the house doing nothing. What the hell's all that about? What a bloody waste of a life. A duvet day? These people, they get up, they don't get dressed... My mate does this with his boyfriend. They get up if they're both off, and they don't see anything wrong with this. They get up, they don't get dressed, so they've got like dressing gown on or pajamas or something, and then they go down on the settee downstairs, shove the duvet over each other, and then watch the telly for 10 hours. I can't understand that at all. What a terrible waste. Of course, you talk to them, they would say there's nothing wrong. Why is there something wrong with that? It's what they do. Well, it's up to you. You know, if you want to sit there all day, waste your life away in front of the telly while I'm up here talking to you. I mean, I could have stayed in bed tonight. But I tell you what, I wouldn't have been able to sleep afterwards. Cool, dear, no. You've got to sleep in the afternoon. You've got to get up then. Got to get up. Probably tonight, I'm looking at the clock. Probably tonight I'll go to bed about 2:00. But I've still got half my Angel Delight to eat. I only have half at a time. Don't like to be greedy. I've still got half my Angel Delight to eat. Yes, please. Yum, yum, yum. Nice, nice. All right, just some final message. Oh, let's do, if you've got any more messages to send in, send them in now, boys and girls, and I'll read them out just before we go. Meantime, let's do today's birthdays. There's only 3 birthdays today, if I remember rightly. Yes, there we go. Mitzi McIntosh. Now, Mitzi McIntosh is a top drag queen who is from Sydney in Australia. And when I went over there, I think the time before last, she was hosting a night at the Imperial Hotel, which is a pub in Newtown in Sydney, doing this thing called Bingay. I'm actually going back here for quite a long time. Bingay, and it was just like bingo. It was like bingo with loads of prizes, and she raised loads and loads of money for charity, and she's fantastic. Fantastic. And she does a really good show. And when you go to Australia and watch these drag queens, they're really good. And everyone sits down and listens. This doesn't happen here anymore. Anyway, she came over here and tried to do the same thing. And I thought she was brilliant. But people are just not listening. It wasn't her. The fault was, because they're doing this to all the acts now, whether they're singers, drag queens, whatever. People just don't listen. I don't understand what all that's about. But she's fantastic, and she really is. And I do hope that she can do her shows somewhere again. She was so fantastic when I went to see her in Sydney. So happy birthday today to Mitzi McIntosh. I think you're such a talented person and a nice person as well, you know. A nice person who's done a lot for charity. Happy birthday to Mitzi McIntosh. Although I see you've left your age off there, my darling. So did you want me to estimate it? I don't know, Mitzi. Happy birthday today to Matthew Bean. Happy birthday, Matthew. Matthew, I think I spoke to you a little while ago on the Messenger thing. Did I bump into you once in a place in Shoreditch? It would have been sort of late afternoon. Do you remember that at all, Matthew? Because it was going through my mind the other day, and I'm sure I bumped into you in this place near Shoreditch. Once in one late afternoon. I'll be going back here about 10 years. Because I do remember if it was you. And happy birthday to JJ Cartwright, who's 20. You're the only one brave enough to put your age on it. I'm not surprised at 24, darling. Looking very good, my darling. Happy birthday for 24 today. Here comes the song, and we'll do your final lot of messages, gang. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mitzi, Matthew and JJ. Happy birthday to you. Did you see how I fitted all those names? I'm going to do that again. Did you see how I managed to fit all the names in quite well there? Here we go. Happy birthday, Mitzi, Matthew and JJ. Happy birthday to you. It's almost poetic, isn't it? It's almost poetic, my singing. I think I should represent the UK at Eurovision. What do you reckon? Would that go down very well at all or not? I'm not quite sure. Mark says, when I'm hungover, I stay in bed. Oh, no, Mark. You can't stay in bed all day. It's such a waste. It's such a waste of time. Joanna says, I do this. You need a day to recoup for the rest of the week. I don't sleep, though. I meditate. Meditating's good. Meditating's good. I do that every Sunday at church tonight. Alan Russell's with us. You're a bit late, Adam. We're about to finish tomorrow. Mark says, what time is our daily show in the international award-winning station we called UK Talk tomorrow, Chris? I'm going out by 11. Are you saying you want it on before 11 tomorrow, Mark? Do you want us to just fit in the show around you? Do you want me to try for 10 o'clock tomorrow morning? I don't like to stick to times, as you well know. But I could try for 10 o'clock if you want. And I think that we've been on the Periscope as well tonight. So I might do that for a while. Do it on both, OK? Periscope and... which I gather... Is it right if you're on Periscope, you come on Twitter as well? Can someone check out my Twitter? And just before I go, can you do it quick? Because otherwise I'm going to... can I look at it myself? Yes. Yes. Oh, no, it says ended. Or maybe it's it says ended there, so maybe it's not on the... Oh, dear, maybe that doesn't work as well as I thought it did. Never mind. Anyway, yes, where were we? I was just reading out those final messages for you today. Thank you very much to Johnny R. Hang on a minute. Hang on a minute. I've missed people out here, I think. Periscope is linked to Twitter. Yes, okay. Yeah, I think we were on there earlier, but I don't think we are now. It must have cut off. Is there a time limit on the Periscope thing, possibly? I don't know. Ah, here we go. Some more messages there. I've got to you now. Rosemary said, I was a nurse. Ah, OK. I was a nurse aide for many years, even thinking about going back into nursing. You love the work and thought of it very challenging. I worked with a lot of elderly. I've gotten been spitting on and peed on. Wow. But it wasn't their fault. You see, that's wonderful of you, Rosemary. Wonderful to be able to do that. Awfully. Had to prepare their bodies for the funeral home. That was the awful part. Yeah. Yeah. Gosh. Joanna says, I want to be remembered for making at least one person happy and smile a day. Are you looking for vocation? Yeah, I was looking for vocation. Rod as well. Vocation was the word we were looking for. All right. Okie doke. Thank you very much to Johnny Key for sending me in a link to these 50 super absorbent puppy training pads with active charcoal, which is something, I mean, how, I'd have to put an awful lot of those down onto the floor though, wouldn't I? But they might be better than the newspaper I'm using. So quite possibly I'd do something like that. And put some of those on the floor. Super absorbent puppy training pads. I'll have a look at how big are they? Does it say 60? Oh, 60 by 54 centimetres. What's that? So it's 10. Oh, that's quite big, isn't it? Isn't it? 50. That's big. For 10. Oh, hang on. 10 quid. Right. One click ordering. One moment, please. Ordered. Lovely. So some of those are coming. I should keep you fully up to date on those, boys and girls, all right? To see how we get on with those. All right. Thank you, Johnny Key, for that. All right. Well, that's it today, boys and girls. Thank you very much for watching the show on this late Tuesday night. Enjoy the rest of your Tuesday, whatever you're doing. I'm going to do some paperwork now, but not before I've had my cup of tea and the other half of my lovely Angel Delight strawberry flavour. Thanks for watching and listening. See you soon. Bye-bye now.